And we will now start with Marta Maia's presentation. It's a keynote lecture on field intervention strategies to control mosquito populations. The Maria works at the Kenry Institute in Kenya, and the title of her presentation is Residual Malaria Transmission is Ivermectin the Queen on the Chessboard. So Maria, the floor is yours. Thank you. Maria, I think your microphone is muted.
I'm trying to share my screen. Okay, here we are. All right, good afternoon. My name is Marta Maia. I'm working at Kenry Wellcome Trust in Kenya. I think my talk will be slightly different from a lot of the talks that have been given in this event. And the title of the talk is Residual Transmission, is Ivermectin the Queen on the Chessboard? I'm sure we all know this, but I think it's good to recall that there have been some incredible achievements in the recent past. On the left, we have malaria, Plasmodium falciparum infection prevalence in 2000, and on the right in 2015, and there has been quite a dramatic reduction in that period. Because of that achievement, the WHO felt empowered to draft a document on malaria elimination and establish some quite ambitious milestones and targets. These have to be, in order for the technical strategy to be successful, they have to be achieved by 2030. And they include the reduction of malaria mortality case incidents, and also elimination in at least 35 countries without reestablishment. So in 2017, the WHO have listed 21 countries that at that time had the potential to eliminate malaria. And this was very useful for the global technical strategy that had been drafted. And those are the countries that you see here in lush pink. And now, recently, we've had some data coming out, and we know that from all of these countries, actually, only three are on track, and those are Algeria, China, and Paraguay. And from the remaining 21, and this has to be achieved within the next 4 years, a few have reached zero, but that does not mean that they will maintain this for four years. Some cases, for example, the Comoro Islands, they had seen dramatic reductions in malaria, and then in the recent years, this has increased again. So the vast majority of these 21 countries are unfortunately not on track. And that is also the conclusion from the World Malaria Report back in 2018, that for us to actually achieve the ambitious goals that were set off by the 2030 technical strategy, that we would need to think out of the box, because what we're doing at the moment is just not enough. So before we start thinking, let's think about how did we actually get here. And of course, we all want a vaccine, and that would be the most cost-effective public health measure. But up till now, it has been very simple vector control interventions that have led to this reduction. And even if a vaccine is discovered, an effective vaccine, vector control will always play a very important role in malaria prevention and reduction of transmission. So this was modeled by Bat et al. In 2016, I think. And you see that in green, the greatest contributor to this drive in reduction has been insecticide-treated nets. to some extent also indoor residual spraying and as artemisinin combination therapies. It's not in on this graph, but I think that also the discovery and the rollout of rapid diagnostic tests had an incredible impact on malaria control. And this has all been a very commodity-based interventions, and it's a universal strategy. So because this is a universal strategy, I have to think back and is history actually repeating? So we look back to 1955, where the global WHO initiated the World Malaria Eradication Program. And this came after World War II, the Americans had discovered DDT, which was a seemingly miraculous tool. It was a one-shoe-fits-all tool, and suddenly malariology and vector biology were no longer necessary. Suddenly, the annoying malariologists and annoying entomologists that needed to understand everything, they were no longer needed in the room. So it was thought that DDT, a one single strategy, would be able to eliminate malaria. And it did in some parts lead to huge gains, but it did not work. It was a failure. And we have to then think about that quote from Albert Einstein: the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results. But at the moment, this is what is being done. We have a single strategy being used in the majority of the malaria endemic countries. So basically, it is really important to understand both vector bionomics and parasite biology. And there's a need to use this understanding to develop better tools. And I really like this graph, although it's not very complete, but it shows that there's so much we need to understand about how vectors behave in order to adequately control them. Because a bed net will only control mosquitoes that feed indoors and that feed while people are asleep. So if you are outdoors, or if you are, or if you're sleeping outdoors, or if the mosquitoes are feeding earlier in the day, bed nets will not work, will not protect you. And the same happens with LLI, with IRS. Mosquitoes that rest inside, that rest outside, they will also not be protected. And we know that there are many gaps and obstacles in the strategy that is now in place. So LLINs and IRS, like I said, they don't impact mosquitoes that feed and rest outdoors. And because of this, it's led to a selective pressure. So mosquitoes that have a higher degree of host-seeking plasticity, meaning that they will either feed on a human or a cow, or maybe even a dog, if they don't manage to feed on a human. And they will feed early in the evening or late at night or early in the morning. So those that are more flexible, they tend to survive. And they are selected. And slowly, they might even become the most important vector. And in addition, the current strategy is entirely insecticide-based. And although we could argue that there is no evidence that insecticide resistance has a direct impact on transmission because of the sublethal effects that we see on vectors, there is a threat of it, and it will inevitably not be a good idea to put all your eggs in the same basket. So ideally, a vector control intervention would have to suppress the anopheline population of any behavioral phenotype and be unaffected by insecticide resistance. So I'm going to talk about one that might be the case. And these fall under the category as of endectocides. And the most developed or the most advanced endectocide at the moment for use in human population is ivermectin. Insecticides are a new malaria vector control paradigm. They're being now investigated. And ivermectin was isolated from soil bacteria in Japan, and it earned the Nobel Prize to Satoshi Omura and Campbell in 2015. And it's a very old drug. We all know it very well. It's been used for various neglected tropical diseases. And close to 4 billion doses have already been distributed through the Mectizan project led by Merck for mass drug administration campaigns against onchocerciasis and lymphatic filariasis. So ivermectin it's an old drug, and perhaps this is a new purpose. It has a different mode of action compared to pyrethroids. Pyrethroids, they the voltage gated, they target the voltage gated sodium channels, whilst ivermectin binds to the glutamate gated chloride channels and leads to locomotor, so paralysis in the mosquito. The digestion becomes sluggish, and there are then effects on both survival and holistically on the fitness of the mosquito. So I bring out another question. Is this really a new purpose? Because actually we weren't paying attention to the veterinary world. Insecticides have been around for a very long time, and perhaps we need to look at the veterinary world for some inspiration, because there are actually long-lasting insecticides that are used in the veterinary. So ivermectin, how does it work? Well, basically when a human host or an animal host is treated with ivermectin, there are residual plasma concentrations in the blood that when a mosquito takes a blood meal from this treated host, their survival is impacted. On the left, we have an illustration from the Ivermal study that was done in Kenya by Schmidt et al. And in blue, you have the control. Red and green are the ivermectin treated participants. And the different time points are time points where a blood draw was taken from the treated participant and fed to mosquitoes. And then on the y-axis, we have the median survival time of mosquitoes. So if you look at this, you'd see that although ivermectin has a very short therapeutic window, and pharmacokinetic studies cannot measure it for a very long period of time after it's been administered, it's thought to be quite small amount of hours that it is available in plasma. But actually it has an effect on the mosquitoes up to 14 days post-treatment. And there are theories that what is causing mosquito mortality is not necessarily ivermectin, but a metabolite of ivermectin that is not yet identified or well understood. And on the right, we have the similar study, but done on cattle. And as you see, the odds of a mosquito surviving after feeding on a treated cattle, even after 15 days post-treatment, it is a lot less likely to survive than the control. Well, in addition to affecting survival, ivermectin has a holistic effect also on the vector population. And this is because it reduces oviposition rates, and it also reduces egg production. So from the graph on top is the proportion of mosquitoes that have laid eggs on the different time points post feeding on hosts post-treatment. And on the bottom, it's the proportion of those, the number of eggs that were actually laid. So we see that not only does it reduce the likelihood of a mosquito to lay eggs, it also reduces the number of eggs that are laid. And this maintains itself for quite a long period, for at least 12 days post treatment of the human host. So I go back to the question that we started off with. So why am I calling, why am I asking, is ivermectin the queen on the chessboard? And take a little bit of a step back to the vector control toolbox in 2017. And you see that if you would want to control vectors that feed indoors, you'd use IRS and ITNs. If you want to control mosquitoes that feed outdoors, you'd use space spraying, repellents, odor baited traps. And if you would like to reduce the population level, the emerging number of mosquitoes, you'd lose larval source management. So now let's look at our ivermectin MDA tool, which is being tested. And if a host is treated with ivermectin, it doesn't really matter if the mosquito is biting the person at night or if it's biting the person early in the evening. So it targets mosquitoes irrespective of their biting times, being late or crepuscular. It also doesn't matter if the person is sleeping indoors or if the person is sleeping outdoors. And because this is a drug that comes from a veterinary world, it can also be given to animals. And therewith, it will target both the human and the animal host. And in addition to that, after we know that it has an effect on the gonotrophic cycle and also on the number of oviposition events and number of eggs that are laid. So it will actually also have an effect on the emerging populations. So actually, ivermectin has a holistic effect, a holistic control of malaria vectors independent of their phenotypic behavior. And going back to treating cattle, I think some of you might ask, why would you do that? Well, actually, there is a very important reason for that. And there's a rationale for having a One Health approach, aside from One Health being a beautiful concept. So if on the far left, you have Plasmodium prevalence from the Malaria Atlas. In the middle, you have cattle density. And then on the far right, the density of Anopheles arabiensis. And you can see that there is an overlap. And this tool would be particularly useful for this Western Sahel and also the Southern African region. Then you can ask, so it affects the mosquito, but would it affect malaria, actually the malaria transmission? And we still don't have a clear indication of this because trials are ongoing and we don't yet have epidemiological data. But there have been many modeling papers on this, and this is one of them modeled by IDM, Prashant Selvaraj, and he looked at, he used a stochastic simulations model where he looked at 100 stochastic simulations and calculated the fraction of these simulations that would actually lead to elimination. And this was defined as at least 4 years of no malaria cases. And he did this simulation for various interventions, systemic insecticides, in this case would be ivermectin, or any other one, but that's what it stands for. And in systemic insecticides in combination or not with dehydroartemisinin and piperaquine, which is used for SMC. And if on the x-axis of this graph, you have MDA coverage. So let's just assume, and that excludes children under 15 kg and pregnant women. So from the rest of the eligible population, let's assume a realistic coverage scenario of around 60 to 80%, you would still see a reduction in, you would still see a potential for elimination, even with a 14-day formulation, a 14-day lasting formulation of systemic insecticides, which is in the light green. And that first graph was assuming 100% coverage of ITNs. So if you would now change the coverage of ITNs, and you would see that you'd have to have pretty low coverage of ITNs to not be able to achieve this according to this model. So there are many current planned trials. These are some of the ones that I've listed. I might have forgotten some. They're done in different areas, not just in Africa. Also, there are also some in Asia. The one that I would be happy to talk more about, if anybody has questions, is this one. It's called Bohemia, and we're using MDA 400 micrograms per kilo, and this is given to humans and cattle. Our sites are in Mozambique and Fiji. We have 159 and 162 clusters, three arms where we measure MDA to humans, MDA to humans and cattle, and also placebo. And we expect to have data in 2022. Thank you.
Thank you. I don't know if you see my camera. Thank you very much, Marta, for this for your presentation.